Welcome to 10 Minutes with Tony Scott. I'm Tony Scott, and I appreciate you tuning in today. Today's show is brought to you by Gentry Academy. Today we'll be joined by Megan Stone from Gentry. Besides being the leadership director at the school, she is the well-known author of the book, Own Your Education, and a monthly guest on the Care 11 Saturday morning show, where she discusses topics on student success. I'm really looking forward to the hearing from her today on the topic of leadership at Gentry. Before we get to the interview with Megan, let's talk a little bit about an exciting week of hockey last weekend. Most of the outstate districts in Minnesota wrapped up district play last weekend. We were in Hibbing in Virginia for the District 12 Pee-wee A and B games. We kept a close eye on teams all over the state at Pee-wees and Bantams. A few teams of note, the Waseca Blue Jays won the District 9 title in Pee-wee B last weekend, sweeping through the field to win. Nice job, Waseca. Greenway and Ely won the District 12-12 titles at Pee-wee A and B, respectively. Both of those teams should be huge factors in the North Regionals. The North Pee-wee A region should be as good as it gets. Alexandria, Greenway, and World all in the same group, and a few plucky teams like Eveleth Gilbert and Detroit Lake should make it a great week in hockey in Alexandria. Here are two important announcements related to hockey. The first is the case of the missing hockey bag. Ethan Schultz from Elk River, who we saw score a big goal in the Moose Goheen semifinals a couple weeks ago, had his hockey bag misplaced into the wrong truck last weekend. As of today, the bag has not been discovered, and he's without his equipment heading into district, region, and state playoffs. If anyone knows the whereabouts of his bag, please contact either Fogarty Arena or Elk River Arena, and someone at either of those rinks can help you out. The second announcement is the executive director opening in Moorhead. Moorhead Youth Hockey is creating an executive director position for their association. This is a great job for someone who has great leadership and organizational skills. Fundraising experience a plus for this job. People interested in the opportunity can learn more about it by going to the employment tab on the Moorhead Youth Hockey Association website. We will now sit down and talk with Megan Stone, a teacher with Gentry Academy. In studio today, we have Megan Stone from Gentry Academy. Thanks for being with us today,
Thanks
Megan.
Thanks for having me.
We are going to talk a little bit about the leadership role. She's the leadership director at Gentry Academy. Let's just talk a little bit about the leadership facet of Gentry.
Yeah, at Gentry we have a triangular model where we put equal focus on education, leadership, and athletics. And I happen to be the leadership director for that.
So tell me a little bit, an example of what leadership is being taught in schools, because it's not being taught in a traditional school. It's definitely being taught at your school. We've talked about it continuously
right.
on the interviews here. Let's get a little bit more in detail about what that means.
So the students have leadership class 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and I teach that. And those skills that we'd be teaching during those times would be time management, critical thinking, accountability, study strategies, and the list goes on and on. But I think the very unique part of it is not only am I teaching that during leadership class, but then each of the teachers are following up with that within their classes. And then also Sean and I, on a regular basis, Sean Skinner, are working on leadership skills that are also on the ice.
So this is a great job for you. I mean, you have your book,
yep.
Own Your Own Success, which is about leadership and taking responsibility of your actions. This is like a great job. Tell a little bit more about why your book fits in so perfectly with what you're doing here at Gentry.
Yeah, it's a great opportunity. I've trained educators across the country and at the college level. I've written curriculum and I wrote my book. And it's just a really great opportunity to bring this into a classroom setting and to also be able to see this not only just in the classroom, but to be able to see this in a whole other facet of these young people's lives, which is their hockey. And to be able to call each and every one of those children to become the best that they can be, even in their failures. We always see failures as sometimes a bad thing, but we really welcome sometimes some of the failures so that they can learn from those and really grow immensely from that.
So let's talk a little bit about, give me an example of how you guys apply the leadership to these kids on a daily basis. I kind of would get it how it would happen in the hockey setting. You know, there's lots of leadership happening. Talk about it in an education setting,
right.
how it would actually apply to them.
So,
on a day-to-day basis.
An example that happened already this year is in the fall, we trained the kids and taught them how to run a meeting with their parents and with their teachers, and they had...
That's a dangerous thing, by
and
the way.
It's a great thing.
Nathan's going to come home and start running a meeting here at your house.
Oh, well, he does every week. So they ran their academic conferences in the fall. So they sat and talked about what they felt that they were doing well and areas that they wanted to work on. Because our belief is until a child really recognizes what they need to change, there's not going to be a lot of change. And so helping them to see that. And then that transitioned into a weekly homework meeting that they run with their parents. And they are called by us to do that each and every week. And then to follow up, Sean and I helped the boys and young girls to run a hockey meeting with Coach Skinner and myself and their parents.
How they would run a practice or how they would
put it was actually how they're doing on the ice.
Oh, and so their own evaluation.
Their own evaluation and Sean's detailed evaluation of how they were doing and their growth areas and places that they wanted to work on as well. So they ran this meeting with their coach and with myself and with their parents, and it was so amazing to see the growth in this. And this is fifth and through eighth graders who are now learning how to run a meeting, sometimes with difficult stuff, and they're doing a great job at it.
So let's talk a little about the soft skills. I mean, mm-hmm. the hard skills are reading, writing, and arithmetic.
Right.
The stuff they're learning here, this is an additional benefit. Tell me a little bit more why it's important for these kids to do this. We talked a little bit about off camera how in life you're going to have these situations. If you're not trained for them, you could be defeated before you even start.
Exactly. Life is going to be hard, whether it's a tough game or whether it's a tough subject or whether if it's a tough situation in your life. But if you know how to do your job of being a student, that tough situation is going to be easier. And it's interesting to see when they have successes in the classroom. Sean usually sees some successes on the ice rink as well. They're very tied in together, and these soft skills will carry them much further on and off the ice, and knowing how to truly control their life and know how to, that they set their course and that they know how to, you know, do their best is just an immense gift that we're giving them.
So let's talk about a little bit what's coming up at Gentry mm-hmm. over the next few months. And we mm-hmm. talked a little bit off camera about what that might look like, what some events have. So I could, you know, a prospective parent, a prospective student could learn more about Gentry.
Yeah, we have three Saturdays, one in March, one in April, one in May. And they get the unique opportunity of sitting in a leadership class and then having lunch with the kids and being able to get to know them. And then they go and spend the afternoon skating with Sean. So it's a really great opportunity for them to see all aspects of our school.
That sounds like a fun day of school.
I know. And then Coach Skinner is going to have a camp this summer, which is a great way to get to know him. And you can always stop by. We'll be at the Hockey Expo at the high school hockey tournament, which we all love to go to.
Yeah, it's going to be a blast this year. It's going to be a great event. So thanks for coming in.
Yep,
thanks for finally letting us in on what the leadership part of the Gentry Academy was. We really appreciate you coming in the studio. You can check out Megan on Care 11 once a month. She talks about how to talks to parents on how to raise better children and tackle tough student matters at the home.
Yep. Thank you.
Thanks again to Megan for joining us here on the show today. Next week, the Minnesota Hockey Coaches Selection Committee will choose 24 Metro teams from the Pee Wee and Bantam AAs. As the weeks lead up to the selection, we do our best to predict where teams will land next Monday. In the business, they call it bracketology. Our final edition of Bracketology will roll out Thursday for our premium subscribers. Some teams are rising, other teams are falling every day. Teams like Forest Lake and Bantam AA, who we currently have outside the Final 24, have a shot to make it with one win on Sunday against White Bear. If the Rangers win Sunday, not only do they automatically make it, they knock out another bubble team. As of our last Bracketology, Lakeville South was the last team in at 24 in Bantam AAs. If they stay at 24, they would be out and Forest Lake would be in. Very exciting stuff. Good luck to all teams this final week at the AA level. This week we will feature three NOW prospects. The first, 2017 NOW prospect, Dayton Rasmussen. We did a follow-up story this week on Dayton and his progress since being named Pee Wee Player of the Year in 2012. It was really fun interviewing him and writing his story. As a follow-up, his team, the Colorado Thunderbirds, won the Tier 1 Elite Playoff this weekend in Blaine, winning five straight games and allowing only three goals in the process. Our NOW prospect is 2017 defenseman Matt Anderson from Holy Family. The Fire had a great week last week, two wins, including a big one over St. Thomas Academy. Anderson had a goal and three assists in those two games. The Fire take on Benilde Thursday in the first round of Section 6 play. Finally, 2019 prospect Ryder Donovan from Duluth East had a big goal for the Hounds in their 4-4 tie with Minnetonka on Saturday, his first of many in a Hounds uniform. A reminder that our summer series tournaments are filling up fast. We just got a commitment from an organization in Colorado coming to our tournaments and lots of interest from Winnipeg and Thunder Bay. Unlike most AAA events, we have a cap on a number of teams getting in at every level. There's a permanent summer series tab on YHH that you or someone from your organization can info that they need. On next week's show, we will interview Adam Michalski from Twin Cities Orthopedic. Adam and I will introduce the TCO to our audience and talk about how their clinic can help athletes when injured. Speaking of TCO, our shipment of Hattie Hats came in today, and they are the new sponsor of the Hattie Hat. Players getting a hat trick at a game we are at, get a Twin City Orthopedic Hattie Hat. Thank you to TCO for their sponsorship. Tweet of the Week. So many contestants this week for Tweet of the Week. My favorite tweeters are the team tweeters that give readers an inside look on a game going on. Egan PWAA is an awesome follow. It seems every game they play in is a one-goal game. Fun for me to follow, not fun for the parents. Staying on that theme, the Tweet of the Week goes to J.K. Hansen, 27, who's the mom of Chaska-Chan Bantam B goalie Taylor Hansen. She tweets, "I don't think this goalie mom can take any more stress of OT and District 6 playoffs. Tell me about it. Chaska-Chan scores with 30 seconds left in regulation to tie EP on Saturday in D6 play-in game, and then beat the Eagles in double overtime. Wow, what a game that was. Then, the next night, with the score tied 3-3 with Edina White, the Stormhawks couldn't convert a 5-on-3 power play at the end of regulation and then lose to the Hornets in OT. A tough couple of sessions for a goalie mom, I'm sure." Boom Roasted. This week, our Boom Roasted writers didn't take the week off. This one goes out to zealous Squirt hockey parents bragging about winning loosely controlled scrimmages that are played at the Squirt level. These scrimmages don't have referees, they don't have a clock, and they don't have a scoreboard. This is not a game, it is an exhibition. Any self-respecting player, parent, or coach that tries to count these as games needs to be roasted. Boom Roasted. Thumbs up. Finally, the exciting playoffs are upon us. We are getting great results and just unbelievable activity all over the state. We appreciate all of the people that are giving us information, whether it be via text message or Twitter. But the most important part is the game itself. We're talking triple overtime games. A 12B game went into 8 overtimes, extending into two days in District 3. What an amazing weekend it was last weekend. We're looking forward to an even more amazing weekend. Our thumbs up goes out to all the players and their quest to continue playing this weekend. Have a good day. Thank you for tuning in to YHH.